Good afternoon students, welcome to the last unit of Transportation Engineering 2, that is Docks and Harbour Engineering. In this particular unit we are going to study water transportation, harbours, then classification of harbours, accessibility, size of the harbours, site selection, shape of the harbours, then harbour depth, marine surveys, harbour planning, features of a harbour, defects in a harbour, and requirements of a good harbour. So this is the last unit in Transportation Engineering Part 2, and here on this particular unit there will be one or two MCQs being asked and a question of 5 to 10 marks question will be there. 2 questions of 5 marks each will be there in your examination. So to begin with this particular chapter, introduction, the importance of waterways in comparison with the railways or the waterways, and need of a place for the approach, that we are going to begin with. Now, water transportation, what is its importance? Water transportation is the basic requirement or the basic branch which deals with the transportation through the water medium. It may be through rivers, through sea, through any canals. Whatever the transportation which is going to happen, we are going to consider that is through water transportation. Now, what are these types of these water transportation? Basically, there are 2 types of the water transportation. First one, inland water transportation, in which river or canal water transportation, and second major category we called it as ocean water transportation, that is through the seas. Now, inland water transportation, that is for the domestic purpose only, on a smaller scale we are going to use it. Ocean water transportation, it is adapted for trade and commerce, basically that for the business trading we are going to use ocean transportation. 75% of the Indian trade is going to happen with the, that is business trading is going to happen with the ocean water transportation. It is having no limitations and it is having with a high flexibility. That is the biggest advantage that ocean transportation is having. Now, some of the advantages we are going to highlight. First, it provides a means of defense. So for the defense only, water transportation is very helpful. Then water transportation, it is the cheapest mode of transportation. Now, if you are going to compare with the different modes of transportation, airways, the costliest mode of transportation, the second one we are having waterways, roadways, the second costliest mode of transportation, then railways, somewhat cheaper, but water transportation is the cheapest mode of transportation. If you require 1 rupee for one of the for taking one of the luggage through the airways, then definitely we require just 20 to 25 paisa for same luggage which is taken through the water transportation. So that is the cheapest mode of transportation. It leads to the overall development of the commerce, industry, and international trade. Next, water transportation, it is having a high load carrying capacity. Now, this is the biggest difference that you are going to observe. In case of the airways, we are having the restrictions for the load carrying capacity, but waterways, this particular ship or vessels, that is bigger ships, they are having the larger load carrying capacity in tons. It also encourages consumption of the foreign goods. This water transportation, it requires cheap motive power for its working, and it is brought countries separated by the oceans very near. So whatever the countries which are differentiated by the ocean, it comes to closer by the water transportation medium. Now, what are some of the disadvantages are there for this particular water transportation? If you are going to compare it with other modes of transportation, that is airways, railways, or the roadways, what are these? It is slow in operation and consumes more time. It is water transportation, the biggest disadvantage, it is slow in operation and it consumes more time. So If you are going to take a luggage through the airways, we require just few hours. But the same luggage or same particular product, if you have to take it through the water or through the ocean, then it will take more time. So it is time consuming. Second disadvantage, it is useful only when water is available as a mode of transport. Now that is the biggest thing that one has to focus. If we are having water which is available with us, then we can go with this particular mode of transportation. Then it may lead to accident in case of frequent ocean storms. Then this particular water transportation is more susceptible, that is, it is having more chances of attack by other countries. Then it is totally dependent on the fluctuations in the water level, which will cause a rubbing of the ships against the berths. So if there is difference in the water level due to the fluctuations, due to the high wind which is blowing, or low wind, high tides, low tides, that will affect the water transportation medium, and it will cause the rubbing of the ships against the berths. And if there are some mountainous rivers, hinder water transportation, then again it will affect the water transportation medium. Now in the water transportation medium, we are going to see the part that is harbor. Now what is harbor? We are going to discuss this. A harbor can be defined as a basin or a haven or a roadstead of navigable water swell protected by naturally or artificially from the action of wind and waves. And it is situated along the seashore, river estuary, lake or canal, or connected to the sea. So what is harbor? Harbor is nothing but a basin which is well protected artificially or naturally from the action of wind and waves. So basin, that is nothing but the area which is occupied with the water, and that is along the seashore or along any river estuary, that is at the entry point of the river, and it is well protected by the naturally or it is artificially from the action of wind and waves. So the particular area or the is called as the harbor. Now see, this is one of the example. If you are going to see, this is the seashore which has been there, and in this particular seashore there is one entry point. Some vessels are there. Vessels are nothing but the big ships, you are going to call it as. The intensity of the water will not remain same inside the basin. It will definitely different outside the basin. So water, if you are going to see, it is steady water we are having, and this water is protected within that particular basin from wind, action of the wind and waves, by constructing the breakwaters. So these are the breakwaters, the walls which you are going to see. So basin. So what is the basin? Basin is a water reservoir of a required area. Navigable water in the basin is greater than the draft required for the largest ship likely to visit the harbors. So basin is a water reservoir of the sum of the required area, and it is navigable when the depth of water in the basin is greater than the draft which is required for the largest ship likely to visit the harbor. Now, what is draft? Draft is nothing but a vertical linear immersion of the ship below the water surface for the ship to float in a stable condition. So draft is nothing but a level of the water level or height of the water level between the bottom of the ship and the ground surface, so that the ship can float on that particular seashore and it is not going to come into touch with the ground surface. So whatever the distance between the bottom of the ship and the ground surface that has been occupied with the water, that particular height of water level, we called it as a draft. Or it is also called as minimum vertical clearance for the safe floating. Now next part is classification of these harbors. These harbors are classified basically into the three major categories. First category, classification which is depending upon the protection needed. Second category, classification depending upon the utility. Third, classification based on the location. So based on protection needed, based on utility, and based on locations, we are having classification of harbors. So first we are going to see classification of harbor, which is totally depending upon the protection needed. So again, into this we are having the subcategories. Please remember, definitely there will be question of 5 marks on this. Classify, give a detailed classification of harbors based on the various purposes, that is based on protection needed, utility, or the location. So we are going to discuss one by one. First, based on protection needed, we are having natural harbor, semi-natural harbors, and artificial harbors. Now, what are natural harbors? These are inlet protected from the storms and the waves by natural configuration of the land. So there is no interruption of the man or human beings. These are totally constructed by the natural configuration of the land, or these are being totally formed by the natural configuration of the land. The natural formations affording safe discharge facilities for the ship on the sea coast in form of creeks and basins. Now, what are the examples of natural harbors? Now, these are the harbors which are been prepared or been protected with the natural configuration of the land. There is no interruption of the human beings. These are naturally made harbors. The best example we are having is Bombay Port, or the Bombay Harbor, and Kandla, which is in Gujarat. So if you are going to see this natural harbor, which has been well protected from the action of wind and waves, there is no constructed area, everything is natural. So this is Mumbai Port, which is naturally available. You are going to see the picture of this. This is Kandla Port in Gujarat. Second, in the natural harbors, natural road states. Now, a deep navigation channel with a protective natural bank or shoal to seaward is a good example of natural road state. And second one is circumscribed natural road state. Now, what is this? If you are going to see the bank of the river or the shoal, and in between this, we are having the road states. Natural road sheds which are available. The picture will give us more clear idea. If you are going to see, this is the harbor area, and in between this, natural road sheds are there. This is circumscribed natural road shed. Second category, semi-natural. So some part is made up by, that is some part is man-made and some part is naturally prepared. That is nothing but semi-natural. It is protected on the sides by the headlands, and it requires man-made protection only at the entrance. So the speciality of this harbor is protection requires only at the entrance, and it should be man-made. Example for semi-natural harbor is Visakhapatnam Harbor. So if you are going to see, this is a natural harbor. The harbor area has been well protected at the entry point, that is prepared by man. They have constructed a breakwater. If you are going to see, some vessels are there. So the entry point for this particular harbor is man-made, and other part is naturally available. So this is semi-natural. So Visakhapatnam is a semi-natural harbor. Some part is man-made constructed, and some part is naturally available. Next is artificial harbors. These are completely man-made harbors. So artificial harbor having no natural protection, but artificial arrangement are made to protect the harbor from the storm and the wind actions. So area protected from the effect of waves, either by the breakwaters or by the dredging. So here they are going to construct the breakwaters, or by using the dredging technique they are constructing these particular categories of the harbors. And artificial road states are created by constructing a breakwater or a wall parallel to the coast or curvilinear from the coast. So this particular road state being constructed parallel to the coastal area, that is along the seashore, or it is curvilinear from the coast. So if you are going to see, this is artificial harbor. They have constructed breakwaters just to reduce the intensity of the wind or the tides which are going to come in contact with this particular area. And this is the middle one, harborage area, wind direction. So a vessel can come from this particular direction, entry point. And inside we are having the basin area. Whatever the water to breakwaters are constructed along this particular direction, so as to reduce the intensity of wind and tide action. So this is artificial harbor again, well constructed man-made harbor. So best example we are having for the artificial harbors are the famous, well, world famous Palm Island, that is in Dubai. So this is artificial harbor Palm Island, that is well constructed harbor in Dubai. Now classification of harbors, second category we are going to discuss based on the utility. So based on the utility, we are having harbors of refuge, then commercial harbors, fishery harbors, military harbors, and marina harbors. So again, there are five categories for the harbors based on the utility. So we are going to discuss one by one. So harbors of refuge, what is it means? The harbors which are used for the ships in the storm and or in emergency condition, that harbors are nothing but the harbors of refuge, good anchorage and safe and easy access from the sea. Example is Dover Harbor, which is in England. Now please remember, these harbors of refuge are basically utilized in case of emergency condition. What are the requirements of this harbor? Ready accessibility from the high seas, then safe and convenient anchorage against the sea we require, and facilities should be there for obtaining the supplies and the repairs. So this is the harbor of refuge. Basically in emergency condition we are going to use it. So harbors of refuge, Dover Harbor in England, the picture we are having. Second category of harbors based on utilities, commercial harbors. It may be a part of bigger complex harbor or independent unit or a single commodity harbor. Terminal as oil terminal or coal port. So basically commercial harbors are nothing but the business harbors where business trading is going on a large extent. Now what are the requirements for this particular harbor? Spacious accommodations for the mercantile marines, then storage sheds for the cargoes. As it's a commercial harbor, so definitely we require the storage sheds. Then ample space for the transportation, loading and unloading of the cargoes. Then we require good and quick repair facilities. We require more sheltered area for these categories of the harbors. So if you are going to see, this is a commercial harbor we are having. So JNPT port is there, one of the port where commercial trading is going on a larger extent. So that is, we called it as a commercial harbor where vessels can come, business trading is going on. There are facilities like loading and unloading of the cargoes, big storage sheds are there so that machineries or some products can load and unload it. So commercial harbors, few examples. Then fishery harbors. These harbors are provided only for fishing crafts and travelers. Only for the fishing purpose, these harbors are used. So that is been provided for the fishing crafts and travelers. What are the requirements of this fishery harbor? These are constantly open for the departure and arrival of the fishing ships. Loading and unloading facilities and quick dispatch facilities for the perishable fish catch. refrigerated stores with ample storing space for preserving this particular catch. As I said earlier, this is only utilized for the fishing purpose, that is provided with fishing crafts and trawlers. So refrigerated storage for storing this particular preserving the catches. The ample space should be there, loading and unloading facility should be there, and it is constantly open for the departure and arrival of the fishing ships. So if you are going to see, this is fishing harbor, only specialized designed for the fishing business only. Then military harbor, next category. This harbor is meant for accommodating naval crafts and serves as a supply depot. The layout of this particular type of harbor is greatly influenced by its location. What are the requirements of this military harbor? It should accommodate the naval vessels. This serves as a supply depot. And Bombay and Cochin harbors are our naval harbors. So basically, these are constructed for the military purpose. So it's a Bombay harbor, which is utilized again as a military harbor. Then marina harbors. Now what are these marina harbors? Marina is a harbor providing facilities of fuel, food, showers, telephones for the small boat owners having temporary or permanent berths. So basically, if business trading is going on, we have to stay, then these marina harbors is utilized for, because it provides the facilities like fuel, food, showers, telephones for small boat owners which are having temporary or permanent berths. The classification of marina harbors, these are categorized into the two parts, that is large marinas and small marinas. So large marinas having 200 and more than berths, and smaller marinas, these are having less than 100 berths. So typical marina layout has been there. So again, one of the picture of the marina harbor where facilities of fuel, food has been provided in this particular harbors. Then next we are going to discuss classification of harbors based on the location. Now based on the location, we are having the different categories of the harbors. First we are going to discuss canal. So harbors which are located along the canals for sea navigation, these are called as canal harbors. Then lake harbors, harbors constructed along the shore of the lake. So very close to the lake, we are having the lake harbors. Then river or estuary harbors, harbors constructed along the bank of the rivers are our river harbors. And sea or ocean harbors, these are harbors which are located on the coast of sea or an ocean. Next point of discussion is accessibility to these particular harbors. Now this accessibility to the harbors will definitely, it depends upon location of the harbors. The harbor entrance should be designed and located for quick and easy navigation of the ships. Then the harbor entrance should be narrow enough not to expose the harbor to the effect of stormy sea, and maximum dimension up to 180 meters. So if you are having if you want a good accessibility, then harbor entrance should be designed, located for quick and easy navigation by the ships. It should have narrow, the entrance should be narrow, and it is not to expose the harbor to the effect of stormy sea. So entry point should be narrow, dimensions up to the 180 meters wide. Then size of the harbors. So size depends upon first number and size of ships likely to use the harbor at one time. Length to 75 meters to 300 meter and width is 30 meter. So maximum length which is going to occur for a vessel in India is around 300 meter long vessel we are having, and width is 30 meter wide. So there should be sufficient area for maneuvering them without any collision. So the width of the harbor gate should be more than 30 meters, more than 50, 100 meters, or more around 180 meters. And length of the longest vessel that is to be visited is around 300 meters. So based on these dimensions, we have to construct our harbor entrance. Now how the size is determined? The size is determined by accommodation which has been required, then convenience for maneuvering and navigation, and adaptability to the natural features. Then what are the different factors which will affect the choice of a site for a harbor, that is site selection for the harbor? Some of the factors we are going to highlight it. Availability of cheap land and construction material. So we should have sufficient space or sufficient land available for us for the harbor construction, and material should be locally available. Then second one, natural protection from the waves and winds. Our site should be such that we can protect our harbor basin from the action of the waves and winds. There should be the natural protection. Then transport and communication facilities. For the site selection of the harbor, we are having transport and communication facilities. Then industrial development of the locality. If you are having a harbor aside, that is along the seashore or at somewhere location, then definitely there will be industrial development of the locality. That is, business trading should be going on in the nearby locations. Then seabed, subsoil and foundation conditions, very important parameter. Soil conditions and foundation conditions, one of us has to focus on for the construction purpose, that is the technical part. Then traffic potentiality of the harbor, that is which is going to visit that particular harbor. It will totally dependent on the business trading which is going to happen along this particular harbor, and utilization basically. Then availability of the electrical energy and the fresh water. What will be the amount of electrical energy which is available in that particular harbor site? Then favorable marine conditions, defense and strategic aspects. So for selection of the site, we have to consider all these aspects in detail. A thorough study is required of these particular parameters. Then one can go for the design of the harbors. For the shape of the harbors, what principle one must has to adopt? The pier heads, one should protect a little beyond to the other to protect from the sea waves. So pier head should be a little beyond so that it will protect from the sea waves. Then width will be widened and very rapidly. So there will be no re-entrant angles which are been allowed for these particular pier heads. Harbor depth, how it is been determined? Harbor depth is been determined as D equals to D1 plus H by 3 plus D2. Now what are these particular parameters? So harbor depth, D equals to D1 is nothing but draft of the largest ship to be accommodated. As I said earlier, draft is what? Draft is nothing but the vertical distance between the bottom of that particular ship and the ground surface. Whatever the vertical distance between the bottom of the ship and ground surface, which has been occupied with the water. So the height of that water level is nothing but our vertical draft. So D1 is draft. D2 is allowance for the squat of moving ship. So what categories of what type of allowance has been there for the moving ships? H is nothing but the height of the storm waves. So what is the longest or the largest height of the waves that is going to meet at that particular seashore, that we have to consider. Generally for our Indian conditions, height of the tide may be 1 meter, it may be 5 meter at some time. So considering the height of the storm waves we are going to deal that, based on that condition we are going to determine the harbor depth. Then harbor and approach channels should have sufficient depth to allow navigation at low water when ships are fully loaded. So harbor and approach channels should have sufficient depth to allow navigation even at lower water when the ships are fully loaded. Please remember, though our ship is fully loaded, but it should have sufficient depth for the navigation purpose, so that particular vessel can come into the harbor or it will leave that particular harbor. And definitely there is some vertical draft been maintained for the loading and unloading and for taking that particular vessel at the corner point. Then there is no obstruction. Maximum harbor depth, how we are going to calculate it? It is equals to the loaded draft plus 1.5 meters when the bottom is soft. And maximum harbor depth is 1.8 when the bottom is rock. Then marine surveys. Now what are the marine surveys been carried out for this particular harbors? Collect the sufficient information about the area before finalizing the layout of the harbor and design of its various components. So for harbor design, we are going to collect sufficient information about the area before finalizing the layout of the harbor and design of its various components. Two basically main surveys we are going to carry it out. First is hydrographic survey and second one is topographic survey. Now harbor planning. It should be carried out after collecting all the necessary information of the existing features at the proposed site. Following important fact should be studied. A thorough survey of the neighborhood including the foreshore and depth of water is necessary. So for the harbor construction, one must carry the knowledge about the foreshore and depth of water in the surrounding region. Then nature of the harbor, whether it is sheltered or not, is again to be studied. So our harbor should be sheltered or not, it will totally dependent on this particular survey or the studies which we are going to carry it out. Then the existing of sea insects and various animals residing at the site should be noted. So whatever the animals or the sea insects which are going to exist at the seashore, it should, or at our harbor site, it should be noted. Borings and sounding should be carried out. Then problem of silting or erosion of coastal line should be carefully studied. Nowadays there is big impact of this particular silting or erosion of the coastal line, and it has been thoroughly studied at every level. It is the most important phenomenon for the harbor planning and the design of docks. That is the problem of silting and erosion. Nowadays there are many research projects and ongoing current projects which are going on related to solve the issue of silting and erosion of the coastal lines. Natural phenomena concerning planning of a harbor like storms, rainfall, range of the tides, maximum and minimum temperatures, direction and intensity of the wind should be studied. So again, some important facts that one of us has to study about the harbor planning. Now the next part, very important. What are these features of this particular harbors? Now for a harbor, entrance channels, then berthing and turning basins, breakwaters, pier heads, quays and wharves, jetties and piers, docks, spillways, other godowns, sheds, barns, lights and fire protection. Now these are the features of a harbor, and this part we are going to study it in our next lecture. If you are having any doubt related to this, please feel free to ask. Thank you. We are going to discuss these features of the harbor in our next lecture. Thank you.